This motorcycle is equipped with a reciprocating piston engine, probably the most common type of engine in the world.
If I take this plastic cup, place it on the motorcycle, fill it up with water, we'll see how the operation of the engine causes very significant vibrations. If we head over to the exhaust, we'll see how the engine produces power in pulses. The exhaust pulses we can see and hear are in fact remains of the combustion pulses inside the engine. But if we observe a jet engine in action, we'll see how there's no pulses or vibrations. All we have is constant combustion.
Now, you might think that I'm comparing apples and oranges here, but you'd be surprised to learn just how similar piston and jet engines are despite their very different looks. Because after all, both of them are internal combustion engines, meaning that both of them combust an air-fuel mixture inside, within the confines of the engine. And both of these engine types, they do intake, compression, combustion, and then exhaust. Inside a piston engine, these events occur one after the other, meaning that first air and fuel comes into the cylinder, we then compress this mixture, after that it's combusted, and then finally exhausted out of the engine. The difference between them is that inside the jet engine, all of these events, intake, compression, combustion, exhaust, they occur constantly and simultaneously with each other. What's also interesting is that both of these engine types rely on two absolutely ancient mechanical devices to function, perhaps the oldest mechanical devices known to man. The piston engine relies on a crankshaft, and crankshafts have been widely used as far back as the 2nd century AD in the Roman Empire, and in the piston engine, they convert the reciprocation of the piston into rotation. And this rotation is then ultimately used to either turn a propeller or the wheels of a vehicle or something else entirely. But the jet engine, it relies on something even more ancient.
And that something is a turbine. Now, you might be tempted to call what's behind me a water mill, but it is in fact a water-driven turbine. Now, there's archaeological evidence of water mills dating as far back as the 1st century BC, so they're pretty ancient. And as you can see, in this one that's not running, we have scoops right there. Water hits these scoops. It causes the rotor, the turbine, to rotate, and then we turn this rotation into useful work.
Now, turbines are present all around us, and they're powered by all sorts of fluids. Wind in the case of wind turbines, steam in the case of thermoelectric power plants, water in the case of hydroelectric power plants, and exhaust gases in the case of turbochargers present in cars and trucks. Now, the big difference between ancient turbines like water mills and windmills and more modern turbines like those present in jet engines or in turbochargers or elsewhere is that we have realized that we can make a lot more power, do a lot more work, if we increase the potential energy of the fluid that's being fed into the turbine. So here we have the turbine of the jet engine. And everything in front of it is concerned with increasing the potential energy of the fluid that's going into the turbine. So now, to better understand the jet engine and to appreciate it, we're going to analyze it segment by segment to see just how it works and how it's capable of powering giant metal contraptions across the sky. We begin with the intake. The two main parts of the intake are the inlet cone and the inlet guide. The cone serves the purpose of reducing drag and helping the air to smoothly enter the engine. The inlet guide also directs the air and evens out the air entering the engine, and together both of these ensure that the air can smoothly enter the engine regardless of the angle of the engine in relation to the stream of the incoming air. The inlet guide also serves a secondary purpose of protecting the engine internals from large foreign objects. Once the air is in the engine, the first thing it meets is the compressor section. As the name implies, this section has the task of compressing the air. It consists of rotors and stators. Again, as the name implies, the rotors rotate, whereas the stators are stationary. The rotors suck in and push the air against the stators and force it into an ever smaller space. This then compresses the air, which increases its pressure and temperature, or in other words, its potential energy. As you can see, the compressor section consists of multiple rotors and stators with decreasing blade size. This tells us that the air inside a jet engine is compressed in stages. The air enters the compressor section at atmospheric pressure, which is 14.5 psi at sea level, but by the time it exits the compressor section, that air will have a pressure of around 70 psi. This is a very significant pressure increase, and if we try to achieve this amount of compression with a single rotor and stator and a dramatic reduction in space, we would likely encounter compressor stall. Compressor stall is a disruption in the airflow that can reduce power if it's mild, or it can even damage the compressor if a complete disruption of the airflow occurs. At that point, compressor stall is referred to as compressor surge. Compressing the air in stages and incrementally increasing its pressure is more efficient and it helps prevent compressor stall. The compressed air now heads towards the combustor. Here, fuel is administered and mixed with the air. The fuel, of course, also carries its own potential energy. Now, the air and fuel mixture is then ignited, most often using some form of sparking device. The mixture combusts, which causes it to rapidly expand, greatly increasing the temperature and pressure. So now we have an absolutely massive amount of energy heading towards the turbine. The turbine captures or harnesses this energy, which causes it to rotate at an increasing speed. Now the turbine is connected via a common shaft with the compressor section. This means that an increased turbine speed leads to an increased compressor speed. A faster spinning compressor then sucks in even more air, which is then fed into the combustor, increasing the strength of the combustion, which then again increases the speed of the turbine even more. As you can see, the jet engine creates a sort of vicious cycle. The faster the turbine spins, the more powerful the combustion. The more powerful the combustion, the faster the turbine spins, and then this goes on and on. The engine is feeding itself. Another thing that works in favor of the jet engine is that this is a rotation-only engine. There is no reciprocation like in the piston engine. Because the piston moves up and down, this limits the maximum speed of piston engines. At overly high engine speeds, the force of the piston is so high that it can damage the engine. And also, the higher the engine speed, the shorter the time window for combustion to take place, and this is why power of most piston engines starts falling off at high RPM, and this is why most of them don't rev much beyond 7,000 RPM. But jet engines, they can easily manage 20 to 25,000 RPM, and there is no decreasing time window for combustion because combustion takes place all the time at any engine speed. So then does this mean that the jet engine is capable of producing unlimited power? Unfortunately, no. Because we have constant combustion, jet engines are limited by temperature. Now, the temperature inside the combustors of modern jet engines is around 2000 degrees Celsius. However, to prevent the life of the turbines from being dramatically reduced, we must feed them with gas that is not significantly hotter than 850 degrees Celsius. This means that we must somehow cool the gas before feeding it to the turbine. If we observe the combustor more closely, we can see one of the ways in which air is used to prevent the meltdown of the turbine wheel. Air comes into the combustion section from three main directions. The first direction is from the front, where it mixes with the fuel. The high temperature of the pressurized air helps to better vaporize the fuel, which aids in combustion quality. Now, this is the only part of the air that actually gets combusted. The second part of the air enters the combustor through these little holes, where it creates a film of air on the surface of the combustor, which helps to shield it from the extreme temperatures of combustion. The third and final part of the air is diverted through the final set of holes, and this air mixes with the combustion flame in order to reduce its temperature before it gets to the turbine. This addition of great amounts of cooling air is why the air-fuel ratios inside jet engines are somewhere between 45 to 1 and 130 to 1 at the exit of the combustor. That is 130 parts air to 1 part fuel. Dramatic power increases would be made if the engine ran something like 15 to 1, but this would result in the meltdown of the turbine wheels. Now, there are jet engines, namely those in fighter jets with afterburners, that run something like 15 to 1 air-fuel ratios in the area of the afterburner. But they can do this because the afterburner is used for relatively short periods of time and because it's located after and not before the turbine wheels. The turbine blades themselves are also subject to advanced cooling techniques. One of these is demonstrated on this engine, where we can see a whole shaft with air holes. Air is brought through the shaft to the inside of the turbine blades. These are then perforated, and air will come out through the perforations to form a protective film of air on the blades themselves, similar to the one present on the combustor housing walls. Now, what we have described up to this point really isn't even a jet engine. It is simply a turbine powered by the expanding gases of the combustion that occurs in front of it. And in that sense, it's not really that different from a gas turbine in your nearest thermoelectric power plant or a turbo in any random car. But as we know, turbos and thermoelectric power plants, they cannot propel vehicles by themselves and they do not create thrust. But jet engines do. So where does the thrust come from? Well, it comes from the rearmost part of the engine, which is called the nozzle. It is often an extremely simple fixed device, but this is what plays a crucial part for every jet engine because this is what separates jet engines from all the other gas turbines. To understand why the nozzle is so important, we must understand that a jet engine is a reaction engine. Whereas a piston engine relies on the mechanical work of the crankshaft, the jet engine relies on Newton's third law of motion, which states that for every action, there is an equal and opposite reaction. What the jet engine essentially does is to move massive amounts of air. It moves these massive amounts of air in one direction, and then the reaction of the movement of this air moves the vehicle that the engine is attached to in the other direction. Obviously, to move a giant heavy aircraft, we must move incredible amounts of air very rapidly in order to generate a reaction sufficiently strong to move said aircraft. And this is exactly what a jet engine does. A typical commercial jet engine takes in 1.2 tons of air per second during takeoff. In other words, it could suck all the air out of a squash court in less than a second, and the airplane has two or even four of these. Now, the thrust generated by a jet engine essentially depends on two things: the mass flow rate and the velocity of the air exiting the jet engine. What the nozzle does is that it accelerates the air coming past the turbine to create thrust. The simplest type of nozzle is the one we see here, and it's a convergent nozzle. Its shape converges, or in other words, narrows down. This forces the gases to accelerate, increasing their velocity, which produces thrust. Now, a jet engine nozzle can do this because the gas turbine of a jet engine doesn't harness all the energy from the combustion. Once the gas comes past the turbine, there is still significant energy or pressure left in it. The nozzle converts this pressure energy of the gas, which by itself cannot create thrust, into velocity, which creates thrust. This is where a jet engine gas turbine is different from a thermoelectric power plant gas turbine. The ideal power plant gas turbine would harness all the energy from the fluid, and the fluid coming past the turbine would basically have no potential energy left in it. The jet engine gas turbine only harnesses the energy needed to spin up the compression section to desired speeds. The rest is left to create thrust. So we can conclude that jet engines are fairly simple, but capable of very high power outputs, which means that they have very impressive power to weight ratios, usually far superior to any piston engine. On top of this, because there's no reciprocation associated loads on the bearings and other engine components, jet engines tend to be very long lived. A good piston engine can do, let's say, 4,000 hours before needing to be rebuilt. Large commercial jet engines, they can do 20,000 hours for most of their key components. Now, the drawback we have is that the constant combustion tends to make jet engines not so fuel efficient. They require a lot of fuel to keep them going, and they're especially not fuel efficient or fuel inefficient that loads where piston engines tend to be more fuel efficient. However, they make up for it by being able to fly higher and faster. So they spend less time in the air, which means that over a long distance, they can actually spend less fuel despite being worse at fuel efficiency than a comparable piston engine. They do this because they do not struggle at high altitudes where the air is thin, where a piston engine would struggle. A jet engine does not struggle because it makes up for the thin air with its multi-stage compression, and then it reaps the benefits of reduced drag at high altitudes where the air is less dense. Now, as a final note, what I have described today is called a turbojet, but this is an ancient design. This is from the 50s. Nobody uses this anymore. What modern aircraft use is something called a turbofan, low bypass for fighters, high bypass for commercial aircraft. But I use this very basic design because it's great for explaining and appreciating the basics, and in the future videos, we can explore further and see how jet engines have evolved. So that's pretty much it for today. As always, thanks a lot for watching, and I'll be seeing you soon with more fun and useful stuff on the D4A channel.